Elite Facts presents
Cosa Nostra, 7 Facts About the Sicilian Mafia.
7.
Origins. So we all know that Cosa Nostra originates from Italy. However, its first inception dates back centuries. For centuries, Sicily was ruled by a long line of foreign invaders, including the Phoenicians, Romans, Arabs, French, and Spanish. The residents of this island formed groups to protect themselves from the often hostile occupying forces, as well as from other regional groups of Sicilians. These groups, which would later be known to the public as clans or families, developed and enforced their own system for justice and retribution, just so long as they carry out their actions in secrecy. But the 19th century rolled around, small private armies known as mafie took advantage of the chaotic conditions that would occur frequently in Sicily and extorted protection money from landowners.
6.
Italian government. Despite the fact that the mafia and government essentially hate each other's guts, the mafia actually played a prominent role in the unification of Italy. Prior to 1815, the Italian peninsula was a collection of different city-states. Between 1815 and 1870, these states would slowly join together to form what we now know as Italy. Sicily became part of unified Italy in 1861. Unification wasn't peaceful. Crime and chaos were rampant on the island while the government sought to establish itself. In a step that may have helped permanently entrench the mafia in the new Italy, the government called upon them for help in the 1870s. Roman officials asked the families to help them deal with dangerous criminal bands. As you'd probably expect, the mafia do nothing for free, so in exchange for their services, the government would ignore the mafia's protection racket. In its own way, the government was signing up for protection services themselves. The mafia took advantage of this supposedly temporary arrangement to establish its presence in Sicilian politics. Mafia clans quickly mastered the art of political corruption. Votes were often bought through bribery and intimidation. They remain a power to this day, though their influence is waning somewhat. While they don't have specific party affiliations, they do tend to avoid extreme ideologies such as fascism.
5.
Impact on America in the 20th century. With the eventual repeal of Prohibition in 1933, the mafia got away from bootlegging, as that crime ring had become obsolete, and moved into a range of other underworld activities. The activities ranged from illegal gambling to loan sharking to money laundering and even prostitution rings. The mafia would also sink their teeth into labor unions and legitimate businesses, including construction, trucking, restaurants, nightclubs, waste management, thank you Tony Soprano, and the New York garment industry. From all these industries combined, the mafia raked in enormous profits through kickbacks and protection shakedowns. Because of their successful ventures in the world of legitimate business, this allowed the mafias to bribe corrupt public officials and business leaders, along with witnesses and juries in court cases. By the mid-20th century, there were 24 known crime families in America, and there was estimated to be around 5,000 full-fledged members and thousands of associates across the country. It should also be mentioned that prior to the 1960s, a group of government leaders, including FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover, voiced their worries over the existence of a national Italian-American organized crime network and suggested instead that crime gangs operated strictly on a local level. As a result, law enforcement agencies made few inroads in stopping the mafia's rise during this period.
4.
Omerta. For those who don't know, omerta translates to manhood and refers to the idea that a man should deal with his own problems. This saying became synonymous with the mafia's code of silence in the 19th century and has remained since then. The omerta is a strict code that must be obeyed as it forbids members from betraying their fellows to authorities. The punishment for breaking the omerta is death. The reason for this code being a big part of the mafia lifestyle is because discretion is valued, as secrecy is necessary for many mafia undertakings. The values of the omerta can clearly be seen in how the mafia is generally portrayed. Rather than brutish thugs, mafiosos are usually shown as practical gentlemen. This can be made apparent by their appearance, as they are usually seen wearing suits or something that could pass for business casual attire. It's a look that could pass unnoticed in most any situation, and it implies that while a mafioso can get his hands dirty if needed, he prefers to deal in a more civilized fashion. Now, just because Omerta is a code of silence, it doesn't mean you can get away with anything and everything, as certain crimes are considered forbidden under Omerta as they draw too much attention to the mafia, no matter if you keep silent or not about it. Examples include kidnapping and theft on a grand scale. While these rules are occasionally violated, who are we kidding? They probably get violated more than we're led to believe. The repercussions can be harsh. In some families, the killing of prominent political figures is forbidden. This is for the same reason, to avoid drawing attention and repercussions to the family. Occasionally, crimes such as adultery that can cause undue internal conflict are also banned.
3.
Organized crime. In the late 1920s, a bloody power struggle known as the Castellamarese War broke out between New York City's two biggest Italian-American criminal gangs. In 1931, after the faction led by Sicilian-born mob boss Salvatore Maranzano, who was born in 1886 and died in 1931, won the war, he took the title Capo de Tutu Capi in New York, which translated means boss of all bosses. Unhappy with Maranzano's power grab, a rising mobster named Lucky Luciano had him whacked the very same year. Luciano then masterminded the formation of a central organization called the Commission to serve as a sort of national board of directors for the American Mafia, which by then consisted of around 20 different crime families from across the country. New York, which had become America's organized crime capital, had been divided into five main mafia families. Everywhere else in the country that the mafia operated only had one family per city. The commission's role was to essentially be the police and judges for the crime world. This included them setting rules, policies, and mediating disagreements among the families. Each of the five New York families received a vote on the commission when it was established, while the heads of the families in Chicago and Buffalo also got one vote each.
2.
The five families. The five families are the five major Italian-American mafia crime families which have dominated organized crime in New York City since the 1930s. Before the five families were established, there only consisted of two families, Maranzano family and the Masseria family. Both families ended up fighting each other during a period known as the Castellamarese War. The Lucchese crime family operates mainly in the Bronx, Manhattan, Brooklyn, and New Jersey, but also maintains influence in Queens, Long Island, Staten Island, Westchester County, and Florida. The Gambino crime family's main basis of operation includes Brooklyn, Queens, Manhattan, and New Jersey, but also maintains influence in the Bronx, Staten Island, Long Island, Westchester County, Connecticut, Florida, and Los Angeles. The Bonanno crime family, who operate mainly in Brooklyn, Queens, Staten Island, and Long Island, but also maintain influence in Manhattan, the Bronx, Westchester County, New Jersey, Florida, and Montreal, Quebec, Canada. And finally, the Colombo crime family. They're based mainly in Brooklyn, Queens, and Long Island, but also maintain influence in Staten Island, Manhattan, the Bronx, New Jersey, and Florida. If you live in any of those locations and have an Italian heritage, why not try your luck and see if you can join? Oh, yeah, that's right, gang warfare and whatnot. Okay, just watch a bunch of gangster films instead. It's better than wearing a pair of concrete shoes at the bottom of a river. The five families, under the supervision of Lucky Luciano and Meyer Lansky, were responsible for the establishment of the Commission, a council which demarcated territory between the previously warring factions and governs American mafia activities in the United States. The five families in New York remain as the powerhouse of the Italian mafia in the U.S. The names of the five families are attributed to mafia informant Joe Valachi. Following Valachi's arrest in 1959, he would give the police the names of the current bosses of the five families. The names of four of those bosses, Gaetano Lucchese, Vito Genovese, Carlo Gambino, and Joe Bonanno, were used to name their respective families. The fifth family was headed by Joe Profaci in 1959, but it is named after its 1960s-era boss, Joseph Colombo. The Genovese crime family, who operate mainly in Manhattan, the Bronx, Brooklyn, and New Jersey. Even though those areas are their main areas of operation, the Genovese family also maintains influence in areas such as Queens, Staten Island, Long Island, Westchester County, Rockland County, Connecticut, Massachusetts, and Florida.
1.
Family tree and rituals. So if you've seen pretty much any film or television show that has a crime family as the center focus, you'll probably notice that there's a hierarchy to their crime syndicate. Typically, each American mafia crime family was organized around a hierarchy headed by a boss, who ruled with unquestioned authority and received a cut of every money-making operation taken on by any member that belonged to his family. The right-hand man of the whole operation was the underboss, and below him were the capos, or captains, who each controlled a crew of 10 or so soldiers. All men had to be inducted into the family by being made. Each family also had a consigliere, who acted as an advisor and ombudsman. At the bottom of the chain were associates, people who worked for or did business with the family, but weren't full-fledged members. In order to become a made member of the family, the individual must have an official member of a mafia family involved in the initiation ceremony, in which a person performed such rituals as pricking his finger to draw blood and holding a burning picture of a patron saint while taking an oath of loyalty. The only requirement necessary in order to even be considered being brought into the family is that the person in question must be of Italian descent. If, say, your father was Irish, you've got no chance of being accepted. Italian heritage was a prerequisite for every inductee, although some crime families required such lineage only from the father's side. And men often, though not always, had to commit a murder before they could be made. Becoming a member of the Mafia was meant to be a lifetime commitment, and each mafiosi swore to obey Omerta, the all-important code of loyalty and silence. Mafiosi were also expected to follow other rules, including never assaulting one another and never cheating with another member's girlfriend or wife. But so long as you obey these rules, you were pretty much set for life. Well, unless you were caught by the police, in which case you were more or less screwed, to say the least.
Don't forget to like us and subscribe for more Elite Facts.